Thank you to everyone who has let me perform at the Trans Equity Summit this year. And thank you to all my trans siblings for supporting me. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Hildy. Oh my gosh, that was fabulous. That was shamazing. And Hildy, I want to say hi to you before you leave today. So yes, let's give a big virtual round of applause to Hildy. If you have your hearts and your smiles and your thumbs ups emojis, please make sure that you're also supporting those artists that way as well right here on the virtual links. All right. Next up, we have another performer for you who I'm really excited to introduce to all of you. Next is Serenity Watkins. Serenity is known as AKA Mother. Mother Escada is the mother with the most, the baddest legendary mother in the Midwest. So please, let's give a big virtual round of applause for Serenity Watkins right here with Rare. And also thank you to Rare Productions today for being here. Who is also sharing and helping our artists perform today. So let's give it up for Serenity Watkins right here for the 8th Annual Trans Equity Summit in the Twin Cities. Enjoy.
Believe, oh, hope is friend.
Yes, let's give it up for Serenity and London. And I thought that the one intro was just for Serenity, so I would like to give London her introduction as well. London Dark Horse Escada from the International House of Escada. London is the international face of Ballroom London and uses she, her pronouns and is the reigning and undefeated Midwest face. So again, let's give a virtual clap and smiles, thumbs up for both London and Serenity. Thank you so much. All right, so we're one performer shy, but that's okay. Rare Productions is coming through. So thanks to Roxanne Anderson and Anna Meyer of Rare Productions for these amazing, fabulous artists today. We're gonna bring Hildy back on. Hildy's gonna come and do one more set. Yes, there they are. Hi, Hildy. I love you and adore you, and I cannot wait to see you after. After this, we'll announce our fabulous keynote, Erica Woodland. All right, Hildy, let's go. Kick it off.
Even the stars and the moon don't shine quite like we do. Dreamers searching for the truth. Gonna wanna read about us in the news. Pretty reckless, pretty wild. Talking, we'll just smile. Don't you see these slipping crowds?
If you know what I mean, you on the team. This is a hymn for the hymnless Christian or religion. Yeah, we keep on singing. Yeah, we keep on singing. Flying down the highway, that's the end of Hyundai. They look to the front, let it run, we don't ballet. Sorry if you're starstruck, blame it on the stardust. I know that I'm perfect, even though I'm messed up. Hymn for the hymnless, don't need her forgiveness. Cause if there's a heaven, don't care if we get him. This is a hymn, for how we
after all we've been through. No, we won't stand and salute. No, we deserve, we disprove. Living like there's nothing left to lose. If we die before we wake, who we are is no mistake. This is just the way we're made. If you know what I mean, you're on the team.
This is a hymn for the hymnless. Kids with no religion.
Yeah, we keep on singing, yeah, we keep on singing. Flying down the highway, backseat in the Hyundai. But look to the front, let it run, we don't valet. Sorry if you're starstruck, blame it on the stardust. I know that I'm perfect, even though I'm messed up. Him for the hymnless, don't need no forgiveness. Cause if there's a heaven, don't care if we get in. This is a for how we live. This is a hymn for how we live, for how we live. Yeah, we keep on sinning, yeah, we keep on singing. Flying down the highway, yeah, we do it our way. Highest out of space, we don't hear what the rest say. Sorry if you're starstruck, blame it on the stardust. I know that I'm perfect, even though I'm messed up. Feel for the hillless, don't need no forgiveness. Cause if there's a heaven, don't care if we get in. This is a hill. Oh, but we live, oh, this is a hymn for how we live, for how we live.
Thank you.
Yes, oh my goodness. Let's give so much virtual love to these amazing, fabulous performers. London, Dark Horse Escada, Serenity Watkins, and of course, Hildy Edwards. Thank you again to Roxanne Anderson and Anna Meyer of Rare Productions for promoting and inviting these fabulous artists today to the Trans Equity Summit. All right, we're a little early on the keynotes, but I'm really honored and super excited to introduce this keynote. I've been able to introduce so many fabulous, amazing past keynote speakers here for the Trans Equity Summit, Tona Brown, Precious Brady Davis, and this one is no other. So I'm super honored and I cannot wait to hear him speak. Erica Woodland is a Black, queer, genderqueer facilitator, consultant, and healing justice practitioner born and raised in Baltimore, Maryland. He is also a licensed clinical social worker committed to working at the intersections of movements for racial, gender, economic, trans, and queer justice and liberation. For the past 18 years, Erica has worked as a community organizer, case manager, therapist, life coach, facilitator, trainer, social worker, program director, researcher, and clinical supervisor with youth, people of color, and LGBTQ people from Baltimore to Oakland, California, where he currently resides. He has done extensive work in prisons, jails, group homes, psychiatric facilities, schools, nonprofit organizations, community-based clinics, and grassroots groups, giving him a wide range of experience to draw from him from in his practice. From 2012 to 2016, Erica served as the field building director for the Brown Boy Project, a national gender justice organization transforming the way communities of color experience gender. He has a private practice in the San Francisco Bay Area where he provides psychotherapy and clinical supervision. In 2017, Erica was awarded the Ford Public Voices Fellowship and had his work featured in Role Reboot, Yoga International, and Truth Out. Also in 2017, Erica was awarded the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation Culture of Health Leaders Fellowship. It is an honor to welcome our keynote speaker for the 8th Annual Trans Equity Summit. Please give a big Minneapolis warm welcome to Erica Woodland.
Good afternoon. Thank you so much for that beautiful opening. Thank you for having me. My name is Erica Woodland. I use he, him, his pronouns. I'm a Black transmasculine person with long brown locks. I'm wearing a deep red button-down shirt and a brown beaded necklace that I hope you can see, one of my favorites. I'm sitting in my office in a large open space with light gray walls and a wooden screen behind me. It is a deep honor to be here with you this afternoon and to participate in the 8th Annual Trans Equity Summit. I offer deep gratitude to the countless people whose labor and love have helped to create this space. We are living in a powerful and simultaneously terrifying moment. We're witnessing the dissolution of old and unsustainable structures and ways of being as we usher in a more liberatory future. This is a time that requires our collective leadership, imagination, and healing as trans, two-spirit, non-binary, and gender non-conforming people. If we could share the slides at this point, that'd be great. Today, I offer this keynote to inspire and potentially agitate us towards building what we need now, today, for our liberation and healing. We will explore the role of healing justice as a strategy for collective liberation, first by exploring the history and lineage, followed by naming and defining this framework and where it comes from. We will then explore critical questions and strategies in our liberation work together. Next slide. So this next slide is on a white background and there's a beautiful image of a hawk with its wings outspread. Before we begin, we must honor those on whose shoulders we stand. I give thanks to the first peoples of this land. I am currently based and originally from the land of the Piscataway, Nanticoke, and Susquehannock, also known as Baltimore, Maryland. I also call the land of the Ohlone, the Bay Area, also known as Oakland, another home and sanctuary where I lived for more than 13 years. These lands, with their specific legacies of resistance, rebellion, and liberation, have been my teachers in this work. I give thanks to all the ancestors whose names are both known and unknown, who have made it possible for us to be here today. I specifically acknowledge those Black, queer, and trans revolutionary ancestors who survived and whose sacrifice has been integral to my own healing. We are living in the midst of intersecting and escalating crises, which our peoples have anticipated for generations. We know that these times will continue to disproportionately impact the lives of trans, two-spirit, non-binary, and gender nonconforming folks, Black and Indigenous and people of color, sick and disabled people, poor and low-income folks, migrants, women, and femmes. From the climate catastrophe to the pandemic, economic and political instability, the rise of state violence and vigilantism, trans communities continue to bear a particular weight of these struggles. And yet, we know how to survive. We are wired for resistance. Minneapolis holds a particular legacy and lineage of healing justice, abolitionist strategy, and movement building that ripples across communities throughout the country. The solutions we seek are reflected in the radical work happening now, in the trans activism and organizing that is part of the history of this summit. The audacious experiments we must engage in to reclaim our power and our dignity. I offer reverence to the generations of work to build power, networks of care, safety, and healing in Minneapolis, and that continue to inspire my work in these times. We are being called to both remember and reimagine the radical possibilities of a future that no longer relies on carceral strategies and criminalization. Next slide. So on this next slide, there's a number of images. There's the logo for the National Native American Boarding School Coalition. In the center, there is a map of the Underground Railroad. In the bottom left, there is an image of some folks in the Black Panther Party with afros. There's an image of a protest led by the Young Lords. And there's also the logo for ACT UP. In order to understand healing justice as a strategy for our liberation, we must first understand where it comes from. Without this grounding, we run the risk of believing we are creating something totally new. Without this grounding, we are cut off from the lessons and resources of previous generations that we desperately need. The language and current understanding of healing justice is relatively new, but the reality is that every movement for our liberation has relied upon strategies of care, safety, and healing. From the Underground Railroad and the movement to abolish slavery, which relied upon a network to provide safe houses, food, information, and care for Africans fleeing enslavement, to the Boarding School Healing Coalition, which represents generations of work to intervene on generational trauma experienced by Native Americans and survivors due to the US boarding schools and adoption policies. The Black Panther Party provided political education, self-defense, and survival programs such as the Free Breakfast Program and free health clinics. The Young Lords, a Puerto Rican liberation organization, took over the Lincoln Hospital in the South Bronx in 1970 to implement a drug program by and for the people in a radical act of health activism. ACT UP, or AIDS Coalition to Unleash Power, began as a grassroots political organization that engaged in direct action and community organizing to engage community members and health providers to fight for dignity and care for people living with HIV and AIDS. These are just a few examples of this rich history of healing justice that shapes our work today, whether we know it or not. What stands out to me in these examples is that each of them are a direct confrontation of structural violence, colonization, attempted genocide, and enslavement. Their strategies include engaging in activities deemed quote unquote illegal by the state and highlight the importance of the risks we must take for our collective liberation and survival. So as we move through our talk today, I want to invite folks, as questions come up, to please put them in the chat box or in the Q&A box. So there'll be time to engage with them towards the end. Next slide. So on this slide, on the right side, there is an image of a piece of artwork by Micah Bazant, who was a trans political artist. The image has a colorful background with hues of orange and a drawing of Sylvia Rivera with shoulder length hair, earrings, and a white top. The top of the art piece reads, "No pride for some of us without liberation for all of us." The text on Sylvia's shirt reads, "Sylvia Rivera was a mother of the trans and queer liberation movement. She dedicated her life to helping trans youth, sex workers, and poor and incarcerated queers. We honor her legacy by supporting trans women and femmes of color to live and lead." The Street Transvestite Action Revolutionaries, or STAR, offer a bold example of the lineage of healing justice led by and for trans, queer, and gender nonconforming people of color. Founded in 1970, in the midst of revolutionary organizing around gay liberation, Black and Brown liberation, and women's liberation, STAR was led by Sylvia Rivera and Marsha P. Johnson, and served as a site of activism, organizing, safety, and care for criminalized survivors, which includes gay and trans youth, sex workers, drug users, houseless folks, hustlers, and others engaged in street-based economies. The Star House served as a space of safety and belonging for those deemed disposable by our society. Star's political work focused on combating criminalization and the antagonization and marginalization of trans people in the broader gay liberation movement. Star also worked to build solidarity with other liberation groups of the time, including the Young Lords. Next slide. On this slide, we have another beautiful piece of art by Micah Bazant. This image has a bright blue background with a drawing of Marsha P. Johnson in the center. Marsha has a crown of flowers, a blue beaded necklace, and a white shirt. The writing at the top of the art reads, "No pride for some of us without liberation for all of us." And the text on Marsha's shirt reads, "Marsha, pay it no mind Johnson, was a mother of trans and queer liberation movement. She dedicated her life to helping trans youth, sex workers, and poor and incarcerated queers. We honor her legacy by supporting trans women of color to live and lead." While STAR represents an important example of this legacy of healing justice and liberatory praxis, it is important that we don't romanticize this history. Sylvia and Marsha are the first to remind us to avoid superficial, reductionist, and convenient solutions. Instead, STAR is a reminder that trans people have always created our own solutions when mainstream institutions neglected us, harmed us, and abandoned us. As trans people, we have also had to confront these same harms from within other movements for justice, such as movements for the broader LGBTQ, racial, gender, migrant, economic, and reproductive justice movements. STAR inspires us to center strategies based on mutual aid, harm reduction, and healing justice, all of which are strategies that require abolition. Next slide. And as we continue to move through and honor the history and lineage of healing justice, we come to the Kindred Southern Healing Justice Collective, which is known as one of the primary architects of the healing justice framework. Much of what I understand about this framework comes from the work of Kindred and the work of Kara Page, a dear comrade and co-founder of the Kindred Collective. Kindred began in 2005 and is a Black feminist-led, multiracial, intergenerational, queer, and allied network of Southern-based practitioners rooted in social justice. Kindred was born as a direct response to burnout, trauma, and crisis inside of our movements for liberation. Kindred defines healing justice as a political strategy to intervene and respond to generational trauma and systemic oppression, and to build community and survivor-led responses rooted in Southern traditions of resiliency to sustain our emotional, physical, spiritual, psychic, and environmental well-being. As we witness the wholesale co-optation and misappropriation of healing justice by white practitioners, many people believe healing justice is solely about self-care and not strategy or building power. Kindred Collective's core values are the foundation of the healing justice work we see today, and their contribution must be named and recognized. Next slide. I am proud to name that I am the founding director of the National Queer and Trans Therapists of Color Network, and we are part of this lineage of healing justice that I just shared. Started in 2016, our work seeks to intervene on the lack of radical mental health supports by and for queer and trans people of color. We seek to build power and political alignment amongst practitioners in our community. We offer healing justice as a framework and a set of strategies to orient queer and trans mental health practitioners of color towards abolitionist frameworks instead of the carceral strategies offered by the medical industrial complex. Our definition of healing justice was developed with Kara Page, a former advisory committee member, in 2017 in a series of strategy conversations. And I offer this grounding here to help us grapple with how we can use these strategies for our work. Healing justice is both a political and spiritual framework that is rooted in disability justice, environmental justice, reproductive justice, harm reduction, transformative justice, and abolitionist movements. This framework is also rooted in the ancestral traditions and practices of people of color, poor people, people with disabilities, women, femmes, and queer and trans people. Next slide. It recognizes the ways that historical trauma and structural violence have caused harm, grief, crisis, trauma, and further cycles of violence for oppressed people. Healing justice honors our inherent ability to heal and the specific legacy of resistance and resilience for queer and trans people of color. Next slide. It requires that we constantly reimagine what is possible regarding our healing, safety, sustainability, and fortification. I would like to consider what this history, lineage, and these definitions can offer us in this moment as we move towards trans liberation. First and foremost, we must not shy away from abolition as the end goal. When I speak of abolition, I am referring to the entire carceral system, including prisons, policing, criminalization, and surveillance. I'm also referring to the ways that this carceral system is the foundation of the medical industrial complex, our healthcare system, which also seeks to surveil, control, and coerce us into accepting conditions of violence under the guise of care. When therapists, health practitioners, and healers reinforce notions of our inferiority through curative models that are rooted in ableism, or collude with the state to provide care, we are perpetuating harm. Specifically for trans people, this harm increases the likelihood that we will not survive and that we will be pushed further to the margins of any movement for our liberation. I believe the structural violence is at the root of all of our trauma. Even when communities experience traumatic events, when they are rooted in their resources and traditions of healing, they do not experience long-term traumatic impact. Communities that are highly traumatized are easier to control and abuse. And that is by design that we've been cut off from our tools, traditions, and practices. And so if our trauma is political, therefore so is our healing. Tending to trauma in our communities and movements is difficult and essential. When we avoid this work, it impacts our assessment of the context and conditions we seek to change and thereby affects our strategy. How can we be successful when we are in a collective traumatic response due to generations of degradation? What I am proposing is not easy, and it is not meant to be. And for many, it may feel impossible. But we must remember that our peoples have always faced this question as part of our liberation work. Next slide. So I hope to offer some important questions for us to grapple with in lieu of answers, to move us towards the complexity, nuance, contradiction, and tensions that true liberation requires, and away from shortcuts and easy answers. So these questions are, what is the day-to-day work we must engage in to build a world no longer invested in carceral strategies? How can healing justice be used as a strategy to get us closer to the worlds we dream of? How does healing justice strengthen our organizing and movement building work as trans, gender nonconforming, non-binary, and two-spirit people? The reality is that we engage in these strategies all the time. Because as trans folks, we cannot rely on institutions to solve our problems. There are many historical examples of this, as well as current examples. Whether they be governmental institutions or nonprofits, how do we learn to recognize the strategies that already exist that are rooted in our community? How do we remember not to give our power away to systems and institutions founded on harm and violence? And how do we collectively engage in healing work to transform the ways we've internalized carceral strategies? We have a responsibility to center our healing in our activism and movement work to help us build power. This can and will be complicated and messy, and we won't get it right. I encourage us to consider our individual and collective trauma responses and how this impacts our strategies, but also how we do the work. What does it mean to claim longevity in this fight for liberation? How do we tend to the ways this work will expose us to more trauma and violence? Given the history of erasure and subjugation, even within movements for our freedom, healing justice offers strategies and memory to build power and solidarity with others while demanding trans liberation as a requirement for our collective liberation. Next slide. So on this final slide, there is an blue and pink image of some clouds and words in the center that says healing justice strategies for trans liberation. As we see the rise of trans leadership, particularly the leadership of trans people of color, we must recognize the ways institutions have and will continue to absorb the language of our movements to undermine our work. This co-optation typically involves tokenization, and as trans and queer people, and as Black, Indigenous, and people of color, we must not be susceptible to this. As we engage in strategies both inside and outside of these systems, because we actually need both, we must not forget that institutions rooted in legacies of violence are not responsible for liberating us. We are responsible for our liberation. We are responsible for our liberation. When we seek to enter systems that have historically harmed us and our people, have been unaccountable and refuse to transform, we must do this strategically and in relationship to outside strategies that seek to build power and set a liberatory agenda. We can expect to experience harm and trauma inside these institutions, and so can anticipate the need for spaces of healing, care, and safety. Healing justice also demands that we always consider how we are building power to change the conditions of violence in our lives, not to focus on strategies of coping or resilience or the performance of accountability, but to keep our eyes focused on liberation. These may be hard truths to grapple with, but the state is very adept at distracting us from the real work. Similarly, these nonprofit organizations and so-called systems of care are also engaging in the same strategies of co-optation and tokenization. We need more formations, more organizations, more groups created by and for trans people that are rooted in an abolitionist framework. Otherwise, we may succumb to these same mistakes. I share this as someone who started an organization that is part of the nonprofit industrial complex, so I sit with these questions every day. The true work of liberation must be embodied and part of every single interaction we have with ourselves, each other, the land, and all the beings we get the privilege to share this planet with. We must vision, dream, and imagine the worlds we deserve. Celebrate the ways that we are already winning. We must study the past, honor our revolutionary inheritance, and do all that we can to ensure that we do not recreate the same harmful solutions we've been subjected to. We do this together with humility, courage, and the audacity to believe that we will win. I want to thank each and every person who's in attendance today, who's watching this on live stream, and I'm really hoping that we can open up the space for some questions and comments so that we can have a more interactive experience together. Thank you. And again, you can put your questions in the chat box. You can put them in the Q&A box. And I'm hoping if there's any questions on Facebook that they somehow make their way over here as well. All right, so we have a question here from Jasmine. Was there a significant event that prompted your passion for this work? There's been several. I think the most impactful one is related to how I made the decision to move towards social work and away from medicine. So in college, I was on track. I'd taken all the pre-med requirements and I was ready to join the profession as a doctor. And I was really excited about that. I was someone who saw that as the best way to use my skills as somebody who wanted to be of service. And during the training that it required, I saw firsthand just the blatant medical racism that was inside of that work. And I got to a point at the end of my pre-med requirements where I decided that it was not going to be ethical or right for me to continue on that path. And so instead of taking the last requirement, which was organic chemistry, if anyone has taken that, you already know, this was an easy choice. I took a class on the history of the Black Panther Party. And that accelerated my political consciousness. It accelerated the ways that I started to understand how these systems and structures of violence are by design. I started to understand my individual experience of internalized inferiority as connected to these systems and this history. And I got to see revolutionary examples of ways to intervene, right? And in this class, we were expected to do a really deep dive. We're expected to grapple with abolition as a set of strategies. And it was one of those moments where I took a risk. And, you know, in hindsight, now it makes complete sense, but I didn't know what that choice was going to mean. And as a result of that, I moved back home from college, actually started to do work around prison abolition, do work around freeing all political prisoners, and actually met my mentor, Marshall Eddie Conway, who's a former Black Panther and former political prisoner, shortly after making that decision, right? And so there's a way that had I stayed on the path that was set out for me, I probably wouldn't be doing this work in this way. And by rejecting medicine, right, it brought me to more liberatory frameworks. Now, I am not going to hold up social work as an example without flaws, right? Because social workers are deeply, deeply responsible for lots of harm in our community. And social work for me is a set of tools to support my ability to work with collective trauma, historical trauma, and intergenerational trauma has been really useful. But really being exposed to abolition as a young person brought me to this work today. All right, so we have some more questions here. From Andrea, please say more about the medical industrial complex as the foundation of these structures of violence. Absolutely. So the medical industrial complex is referring to systems of healthcare, pharmaceutical companies that are really rooted in this idea that there is a model of health that is rooted in being white, male, wealthy, Christian, and cisgender, right? When we engage with the medical industrial complex or the mainstream healthcare system, we have to remember that that system was developed in the context of genocide and in the context of enslavement, in the context of land theft and labor exploitation. And so that system seeks to continue to reinforce inferiority of all the folks who don't represent dominant society. And the medical industrial complex in my work as a psychotherapist is really important because oftentimes folks of color, queer and trans folks, we come to this profession because we want to help people, but we're not aware of that history. We're not aware of that legacy. And we don't have a critical understanding of the way that capitalism and ableism come together to really keep a certain group of people or many groups of people at the bottom in this hierarchy that is set up in society. So prior to learning about the medical industrial complex, I thought becoming a doctor was a good idea. And I'm not knocking becoming a doctor. We have a lot of radical healthcare providers and we have a lot of folks who are organizing healthcare providers to move towards more abolitionist frameworks. But that system embedded in it is white supremacist values and values that say that we're not worthy, right? That we are diseased inherently and that we do not deserve to be alive. And so when we think about this in the history and context and legacy of eugenics and population control, it's really important that we as practitioners understand that history before we join any kind of role where we're representing the medical industrial complex. All right, one more question, let's see. All right, so from Magpie, we have, you mentioned needing more organizations grounded in abolition frameworks. Do you have any suggestions or resources for how to form one without draining yourself? I'm coming from disability limited energy perspective. Absolutely. So there is so much radical work happening in Minneapolis right now that I don't know that you would need to start something. My first recommendation to anyone who's interested in joining this movement is to really start to ask questions about what already exists. What can you already connect to? I know that in the work that I do as part of the network, you know, we have a lot of people who are starting things now, and that's really beautiful. We also need to make sure we're coordinated and that we're aligned. And a lot of the radical work that I'm aware of that's happening in Minneapolis, I think would be a great place to start. So I'm thinking of groups like the Minneapolis Healing Justice Network. I'm thinking about some of the work that's happening with RAP, with alternatives to policing. I think it's really important to check out what's already there, because what we know is that even if we're not aware of it, this work is always happening. And sometimes it's just a matter of lifting it up, connecting, and figuring out how we can best contribute. All right. So we have some more questions. I'm going to go into the Q&A box. All right. So this question I'm going to pull out is about how we avoid slipping into co-optation, which I think is great. What tools do you have, or do you think we collectively need to develop to keep us oriented towards liberation and abolition and not slipping into co-optation? So I'm gonna actually share a personal story to engage with that question. When I chose to go to graduate school, get a master's in social work, go into more debt to get a set of skills that I felt like I needed to do the work that I was doing, I actually pulled together my comrades and I asked them to serve as a council of support and accountability around my values. So I knew, coming from community organizing work, coming from harm reduction work, coming from work around HIV AIDS, that social work was gonna put me in a number of situations where I was engaging in conflict around my values. And so I made an intentional choice to have people check me. I made an intentional choice to ask people to be in ongoing conversation with me about how what I was learning in school, the interventions that I was doing in school, how that was aligned or not aligned with abolition and liberation. And so for me, that's a really important place to start, because we actually can't do this on our own. We have to do this in community. And we have to grapple with the fact that we're not going to resolve those contradictions sometimes, right? Because we're trying to build towards a liberatory future in the world that we have as it is now, right? And so when we think about tools, I would say, you know, bring your council together. Think about those folks who hold your vision for the future. Think about those folks who can help you grapple with what it means to enter institutions where it's easy for our work to get co-opted, our ideas. And also to think about, you know, sometimes I feel like we give our things away to institutions and systems. I don't think everything needs to be in an institution or a system. Some of our most liberatory work needs to remain outside. And so being able to use that discernment has also been really important for me. These are great questions. All right. All right. So there's a question here about how we combat stigma within our workplaces and community that allow us to be able to level equity, deactivate bias and prejudice within the spaces we need. And what techniques do you feel work better within this work to train allies, but also systemically end options that are based out of ism? So this is a good question. I love this question. I think part of my answer to this is to know what lane you need to be in. So I learned early on that I am too impatient and rebellious to work inside of systems. I can work with systems, I can work alongside systems, but it was actually really important for me to own that, like, my best work is creating alternative systems and to really offer other ways of doing this work that are more liberatory, right? Also owning and understanding that the nonprofit industrial complex is also a system that is rooted in a lot of things that we're talking about that was specifically developed to undermine our movement building and power building, right? And so there are no perfect solutions to this. But the first is to understand, like, are you best equipped and is it your best use of your gifts and skills to do that work in systems where there's a lot of work to do, right? The other piece that I generally tell people is to have a strategy. So everywhere I go, I think like an organizer, and I work with a lot of folks who are in systems where they don't have a lot of support and they are alone or in a very small group trying to push change in systems that move really slowly, right? And so in those contexts, it's important to build with other folks, build relationships, build trust, and start to think about what is an intervention that can be done collectively that will actually have impact and how long will that take, right? Some systems move really slow, right? Some systems, especially now that last year, a lot of people had their first awakening around things like police violence and white supremacy. Some systems are in a moment where they're a little bit more open to change, in part because the conversation around these things has changed. And so I think it's really important to just have a good strategy and to know what you can and can't accomplish in the context that you're doing your work in. Sometimes that means really having to face and confront that some of what you need the system to do is not possible, right? And that doesn't mean the work is impossible. Again, we need all strategies, right? So in our work with the National Queer and Trans Therapists of Color Network, we talk a lot about we need inside and outside strategies. We're not going to value one over the other. I know my lane is generally outside, right? But we actually need folks inside. When I've had to engage in systems, right, the folks who were inside, who saw me, who recognized that I needed help, who were able to help me navigate barriers, who were able to give me information so that I can move towards what I need, right? Those folks have been invaluable, right? But we have to support folks who are in those situations. And oftentimes that support might not be available inside of a system or institution, but that support is always available outside of those institutions. All right, let me take one more question from the chat. All right, this is a great question from Zan. What advice do you have for those of us who are weary of being resilient, but still committed to liberation and justice? Ooh, I love this question. You know, the problem is that our resilience has been weaponized. We are living in a moment where more and more the conversation around resilience is about how do we increase our capacity to recover from atrocious conditions instead of having a conversation that's about, do I need to be more resilient or do we need to change the conditions of our lives, right? And so that weariness, I think, is very wise. I'm thinking about when that weariness creeps up in my own body, in my own spirit, And what it's generally asking of me is not only to slow down and tend to a thing, but also to grieve and to be in the space where I can collectively acknowledge that the world that I deserve is not here yet, right? I can create pockets of it, and I do, but the world that I deserve, that we all deserve, is not here yet, is being birthed. And so I think some of us have internalized the belief that we need to just keep being resilient. And I know I've had a number of healing crises where my question was not about being resilient. My question was actually about what does it mean to break apart? Because there's actually a lot of healing in that too. And so there's been a number of times where I've had to take a break from the way I was engaging in this work. There's been a number of times that I've experienced extreme burnout. There's been a number of times that I have, through the strength of community and all the practices that I engage in, that I've been able to come back. But it is a practice, right? And so, you know, we cannot do this work in a way that mirrors the speed of capitalism and ableism. It's just not going to get us where we're going. But that weariness is really real. And, you know, for me, at times that weariness has felt very intergenerational, right? Like that I'm carrying the weariness of my ancestors as well as mine. All right, just, y'all have some amazing questions. I think I'm gonna take one more. All right, last question I'm gonna respond to from Amir. As people who have been victimized and harmed by many of these systems, how do we begin to engage with healing justice as a pathway to our liberation? I love this question. I think it's at the heart of a lot of what my work grapples with. So because we're in a moment where we actually have more translated organizations than I've seen in my lifetime, right? We're in a moment where a lot of groups are having to face into the legacy of harm and violence that they're responsible for. And that includes nonprofits, that includes governmental institutions, and all other kinds of systems. And so for me, healing justice is really about how we build collective power around liberatory strategy, right? And so I think one of the dangers of this moment is thinking that you can take healing justice, which is again about strategy and about building power, and kind of drop it into an institution, right? If your work is not focused on building power, healing justice might not be the strategy to move towards. It doesn't mean healing justice can't inform how you do what you do, but fundamentally, some of the ways that it's being misused and misappropriated is by bringing in self-care instead of changing the conditions that workers are experiencing or changing the conditions that these systems have set up that are harming our communities. So my first response to that question would be to think about some of the healing justice work that's happening in Minneapolis outside of these systems and institutions, and thinking about folks who are building power to intervene and transform those harms caused by those institutions. And to also understand that this is a long game, right? A lot of the things that I'm fighting for, I know I won't see them in my lifetime, right? They might not even happen in the next generation. But understanding our work as part of a long legacy of freedom fighters has been really important for me to right size my contribution, and to not feel like I'm responsible for the weight of thousands of years of degradation. So when we've experienced harm from systems, the first thing that we have to do is tend to our own healing, right? Move towards safety. And sometimes that's impossible to do, right? Because for instance, if you're talking about the healthcare system, right? If you are privileged enough to have access to healthcare in this country, then you might have to engage with practitioners on a regular basis who are harming you, right? And a lot of the work that practitioners that I'm in relationship with are doing is intervening on those things. We need to move beyond sensitivity trainings. We need to accept that there are people who are going to remain deeply invested in queer and transphobia, deeply invested in white supremacy, and not allow ourselves to get distracted by people's performance, right, of transformation, or people's performance of wanting to do the right thing. And I think that can be really hard because, you know, in a moment where we're seeing, you know, just so many or institutions from a place of embarrassment that try to rush to catch up to where we are now in some of these conversations, it's really, really scary to think about the kinds of interventions that are just going to keep a lot of this harm and violence in the shadows, right? I also think, you know, a lot of what we have to grapple with right now is that we are literally being asked to find our own solutions to these problems, right? And so when we think about healing justice, when we think about folks who are organizing practitioners, folks who are politicizing practitioners, we know over time, the more people we have in these environments and in these institutions who are rooted in healing justice as a framework, we will have more safety and we will have more access to liberation, whatever liberation is possible in systems. And so again, as we think about inside and outside strategies in this moment, there's a lot of things that our communities have had to set up for ourselves. One of the most important teachings for me in all of my work is that our peoples have always had ecosystems of care because literally systems would not care for us, right? And if you think about any of the communities that have experienced marginalization and harm, it's really, really astonishing that we're in a moment where, you know, things have changed enough that some of us actually feel like the system is accessible to us, but in a lot of ways it's not. All right. I think they're saying I have a little bit more time. So I'm gonna take a look at some of these questions. I also see beautiful things happening in the chat here. All right, so this isn't a question, but I wanna just talk a little bit about Sarita's lovely comment here about the ways that healing justice has been co-opted by the self-care industry. Yes, yes, yes. So I call that healing justice shenanigans. and the proliferation of self-care, capitalism, branding, Insta practitioners. And believe me, I appreciate a lot of what people are offering via social media because it's very accessible. And because folks are not rooted in the history, lineage, and political values of healing justice, a lot of the current conversation around self-care is just continuing to reinforce our marginalization and continuing to reinforce this idea that on our own, we're just going to be able to heal, right? On our own, instead of focusing on changing the conditions right? Building power, organizing, that, you know, if we engage in a healing practice, whether it's meditation, whether it's a spiritual practice, that somehow that is going to by itself move us towards liberation. And it has been really interesting to see folks also absorb the language of healing justice now instead of self-care as a way to be more current with the language to support their branding and to support the building of their business. And again, individual practitioners in this moment who are thinking about how to do their work in a more liberated and abolitionist framework are absolutely invited to think about healing justice and what that can offer their practice. But your individual care practice is not healing justice, because as Kindred has reminded us, healing justice is about how we are building power together and how we are looking at the ways intergenerational trauma can be transformed so that we can actually be successful and win. And so that in that way, one of the common misconceptions that I find is that people think that healing justice came from the self-care conversation movement industry versus understanding that healing justice came directly from movement, right? I gave just a few examples that are part of the lineage that I touch, right? But what we know is that this lineage is infinite, right? And that our peoples, since the beginning of time, have always had access to these traditions for healing alongside resistance, alongside rebellion, alongside resilience. All right, I'm gonna do one more scroll to see if there's any more questions. All right. So we have another question here in the chat. I'm a student at Carrollton College and I have realized that my campus needs a trans-centered activist group. For those of us like me who feel the need to make a difference but don't know how, what advice do you have for finding a place to start? I love this question because when you are someone who sees a need and you feel called to address it, it can feel really daunting and overwhelming. You know, I'm thinking about a number of the times where I've seen a need like that and some of the mistakes that I've made. And so I'm going to first start with what you should not do. What you should not do is wear yourself out alone, trying to create something by yourself. Is really important to find other comrades who are willing to address this with you. And first and foremost, to understand that in order to move towards any intervention, you first have to start with a foundation of trust and actual relationships and values alignment. So a lot of the work that I do with groups across the country is super tied to, we actually can't move together to try to change something until we know each other, until we know what we stand for, and until we have agreement around what the solution to the problem is. And so starting a group, you know, sounds easy enough. And when I think about the groups that I've started that don't exist anymore, it's because I didn't do some of that pre-work, right? And to know that, you know, we're on these campuses for a short amount of time. And so you might initiate something while you're there that then gets built upon when you're no longer there. And so I think the first place to start is to figure out who else is concerned about this, who can you build with, and, you know, what is the process that you need to go through to start a group that's rooted in a shared set of values. Those values really help you when you move in a way where you're not aligned, when you move in a way where there's disagreement or conflict. Those values can often be our anchor. All right. I saw a question here about training allies. I have a lot of controversial things to say about that. So, you know, in my experience, personally and professionally, I think a lot of people say they want to be allies, but they don't actually want to be allies. It's not really politically or financially feasible to move forward being like blatantly transphobic and queerphobic and ableist and white supremacist. And so we have to recognize that sometimes people's motivation to allyship is to feel better about themselves or to avoid getting called out, right? Or to continue to get access to resources. And so this is why I have, I think that sensitivity trainings are quite limited. Because ultimately, you know, once people have information, the assumption is that they're going to change. But some of the deeper work that we have to grapple with is why people are emotionally and spiritually invested in structural violence and superiority. And those are bigger pieces of work that require people to be committed to doing that work 24 hours a day, right? So I know that, you know, a number of times when I've been in contexts where people are doing this kind of training, it's like you can't expect people to be committed to trans liberation at work, but then outside of work, they don't have to do that work, right? And so in this moment where, again, everything can be weaponized, everything can be co-opted, we have to be really, really careful that we are tracking these things and that we are that we're not, you know, contributing to it, thinking that we have a solution when we don't. And I think I've learned a lot about that from my teachers and my mentors around just the cyclical nature of some of the things that we're talking about, right? If you look at, you know, other movements, some of the things that previous movements were demanding, you know, we got those things and we're still not free, right? And so as we think about what wholesale transformation looks like, we have to demand more than training, and we have to know that that is not enough. Most of the people that I encounter who are deeply committed to transphobia, it's not for lack of information. It's not for lack of information. It's about, you know, the ways we've internalized a gender binary that harms all of us, but some of us really benefit from it, right? And so in this particular moment, you know, where we have a consultant industrial complex, you know, we can waste time and resources trying to train our way out of something instead of just understanding, okay, right now this person is not ready to do transformational work. That does not mean they won't get there, but it means in this moment, they're not ready for that. And so how do you move? How do you move with them? How do you move around them? How do you move without them? And in some contexts, especially if you're talking about working in a system or institution, what you have to do is actually think about how you mitigate the harm that those people are able to cause and organize around them, right? But again, you know, I stay in my lane. That became really impossible for me to do. Because I'm very impatient. I don't want us to lose any more people. I don't want that. That is not the world that I dream of. That is not the world that my ancestors dreamed of. There are too many of us experiencing unnecessary suffering and too many of us who don't even get to live into eldership because of the things that we're talking about. So I rely on folks who are more adept and skilled in navigating systems, folks who are really adept at like the pacing of systems and folks who are willing to give me instruction about how to be in relationship to those systems to support the change work they're moving. All right, I think that's all the questions. This has been incredible. Thank you so much. It's been an honor to be here with all of you. It's been an honor to help you open up this amazing summit, this space. And I am so excited for your questions. I love a good interactive keynote where I'm not just talking into the void, but able to really grapple with some of the things that you all are bringing up. So it's been a deep honor. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Erica. It was an honor to hear you. And I hope that I get to meet you one day if you ever come back to Minneapolis, because, you know, then I can teach you all about this amazing phrase I have. But I'm so honored. Thank you for sharing your beautiful story. And I'm just so grateful that you were able to be here for the 8th Annual Trans Equity Summit here in the Twin Cities. So thank you so much. We're excited to share the next day and a half of programming with you all. Please review your program. Join us for an in-person Korean resource fair and some of our healing spaces tonight here at the Minneapolis Institute of Art, or MIA, and virtual workshops tonight as well. Tomorrow afternoon, there will still be in-person healing spaces at the MIA, as well as virtual workshops and healing spaces and a virtual career and resource fair. And we'll close out tomorrow evening with an incredible panel and some performances. I'm really excited to meet with some of amazing artists, Jean McRyder, Miss July 23rd, Erica Sharkey, and Nomi Bad Boy. You don't want to miss it. We have a lot to chat about. And then also, if you want to stay involved, please look into applying for the City of Minneapolis Transgender Equity Council. Someone will drop the link with more information in the chat right below. And I want to thank all of our sponsors today who have made this possible: our presenting partner, Women's Foundation of Minnesota, as well as Black Visions, Comcast, North Point Health and Wellness, Kirk Nicolet Gender Services, PFund Foundation, Reef Technology, Sewer Co-op, and XO Energy. And of course, thank you to Rare Productions, Roxanne Anderson and Anna Meyer of Rare Productions, our amazing artists, Hildy Edwards, Serenity Watkins, and London Escada. And of course, thank you to Track for all of the hard work that they've done for us today here at the Trans Equity Summit. And we'll see you in a few short hours. And my name is Quinn Villa Gomez, AKA Shimmer, and it's been an amazing honor to be your MC. We'll see you in a few hours. Goodbye.